Now this board here is using advanced radar technology, meaning it can, for example, track a person in a 3D environment. Needless to say, this is pretty awesome, and only possible because of this IC here, whose function it is to obviously be a radar sensor. And each day, new ICs with awesome new functions come to market, which makes it really easy to miss out on cool new stuff. So in this third installment of my Future Tech video series, I once again chose four of the newest and most interesting dev boards and thus ICs to have a closer look at, whose functions are not only a bit futuristic, but maybe also interesting for your next project. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by Mouser Electronics, which is where I of course searched for and got the newest dev boards from. And just for you, they also created a free reference guide about the used radar technology, so check that out in the video description. And besides dev boards, they also offer pretty much every electronics component that exists, and thus I ordered there for years now and never had any problems. So I would definitely recommend giving them a visit. Now let's get started with the already shown radar boards, built around the IWRL6432 radar sensor IC. And I know what you're thinking, and yes, I already covered another radar board in a previous video, so why should we care about this new one? Well, while the old board still does a job of detecting moving and standing people pretty well, there are some big differences between these two radars. For example, the old radar uses 24 GHz, while this new one goes from 57 to 64 GHz. This basically allows for better accuracy, along with some other really neat advantages. But of course, by using a higher frequency, we can penetrate through solid objects less effective. I mean, the emitted wave has to travel through the barrier to the object and bounce back to a receiver antenna to get evaluated, which simply works better with a lower frequency. But if you want all the juicy working principles of such a radar, then I highly recommend checking out Texas Instruments Radar Academy, which is super well made, props to them. But anyway, the last big difference between these boards is that the GP1 uses one transmitter and one receiver antenna, while the expensive one uses three receivers and two transmitters. This makes it possible to see a phase shift between the received signals, and thus, with this information, we can find out how our object is positioned in three dimensions, while the other boards can basically only calculate the distance, so 1D. But enough theory for now. To use this thing, I firstly hooked up the included breakout boards and then had a look at the given quick start guide. According to that, I connected a USB to serial converter to the board, which I then hooked up to a computer. And by using the given software, I firstly flashed the newest firmware onto the radar and then basically started with the given examples. And yes, it seems like the range gets detected pretty accurately, as well as the motion tracking in the X and Y dimension. And while penetrating through the solid wood here was not possible, which, by the way, did also not work with the 24 GHz radar, it was possible to go through something like cardboard or similar. And last but not least, I of course also wanted to try out the 3D tracking, which did work indoors, but I think it is easier to see how well it works when doing this test outdoors. Here we can also see that this radar worked up to a distance of 11 meters, which is quite a bit more than the 6 meter the old radar could do. So all in all, I'm pretty impressed here. The given software works well, the board is great, all documentation with schematic and whatnot is there. There are tons of applications for this thing, and the main IC itself is not that expensive, meaning I'm looking forward to the future of this radar technology. With that being said, let's continue with this dev board from Microchip, based around the MCP22301, which is a USB-C Power Delivery 3.1 controller. And truth be told, in the recent past, I was a bit obsessed with USB-C. So trust me, this board will be the last USB-C thingy for a while. But I had to include it, because it is pretty awesome. Since after plugging in a 240W USB-C cable that is hooked up to a 140W power supply, we can use this rotary switch here to basically switch between all available power delivery output voltages up to 20 volts. This way you can easily power your electronics projects using USB-C, which I've been doing for years now. But wait a minute, cheap USB-C PD trigger boards from AliExpress can pretty much do the exact same thing. And the USB-C board from Santilab that I showed off in a previous video can do even more and go above the 20 volt output voltage. So why should I care about this other board again? Well, the big selling point here is that it is standalone, meaning it does not require an additional microcontroller like the Santilab boards or AliExpress boards. Instead, a microcontroller is already integrated, meaning you can also upgrade its firmware later on, and thus unlock the PD voltages above 20 volts, because the hardware of the IC is compatible with that. And selecting a voltage is also super simple, by using voltage dividers to create different selector voltages. Combine that with the fact that you can also hook up a USB to your outboard to see the available voltages along with the flowing current in a graphical user interface, you got additional MOSFETs to cut current if you want to, and the IC itself is pretty cheap, and you got yourself a very promising candidate for future USB-C PD trigger boards. And pretty much the only downside is that it does not support PPS, aka variable voltages, like the Santilab board does. But anyway, moving on to this board here from AMS Osram, built around the TCS34488, which is a 14-channel multispectral sensor. Let me show you what it can do by simply plugging the board into my computer and starting the given software. Here we can do a single measurement and then choose between spectrum, light information, or flicker detection. And as you probably already guessed, this sensor can basically tell us what wavelengths our light consists of, and thus it can tell us what color space we're seeing. And it can also calculate us some really important values, like the CCT, aka color temperature. Like the name implies, the color temperature says whether our light source comes with a more warm or cold tint, which I can fine adjust with this light source here. And it seems like the sensor gets the right value straight away. Another really important value is the CRI, or Color Rendering Index, which basically tells us how accurately a light source reveals the true colors of an object, meaning in daylight it is around 100 and above 80 for good light sources. For example, in my lab, exactly where I film, I got around 90. And I'm pretty happy with that. So by using this sensor, you could strive to make the perfect light source, which is one of many possible applications. And here you can see why you don't see my DIY LED panel in videos anymore. But besides that, you can also use it to detect flickering, which might not be good for your health in the long run, just like too much blue in your monitor light. But you could also use it for color or material sorting, because of course every color slash material reflects light a bit different. There are honestly quite a few interesting applications for the sensor, which got me wondering why I've never seen a budget-friendly product that can do similar things. I mean, the price for the sensor is reasonable, testing with the given software works like a charm, and all documentation is there. Meaning I'm really looking forward to the future of this thing. And just like that, we come to the last board, which is built around the QPG6200, which is a low-power multi-standard system on chip. I got interested in it because I recently got fascinated by such low-power devices that either use Zigbee or Bluetooth Low Energy for communication. Now what they can do is pretty minimal, but still super useful. So I wanted to create my own low power thingy, and thus looked for suitable microcontrollers. And for me and many others, the most popular in that regard are either the ESP32H2 or the NRF52840. Both of them have their pros and cons, with the ESP being more powerful and the NRF requiring less current. But then I found the QPG6200, which is apparently another contender. And oh boy, according to its datasheet, it sounds promising. I mean, it can use BLE, Zigbee and Thread all at the same time. Got more peripherals, more security, but also draws a bit more current. So I was hyped to give it a go. But sadly, only the bare software development kit is currently available. That is pretty normal to work with for software developers, but I'm honestly too stupid for that and thus could not get anything running. However, they do offer some nice written tutorials and lots of example sketches that you can of course adjust and customize. Combine that with some great hardware and the price of this SoC, and I feel like this could be a great fit for secure, mass-produced, low-power thingies. And with that being said, I think we discovered some pretty cool new stuff today. And maybe you found something useful for your next projects. Don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!